about feelings in your heart. Don't let fear of feeling fool you. What you see sets you apart. And there's nothing here to bind you. It's no way for life to start. Do you know that tonight the streets are vision and our goals. Oh, the trigger of time, it tricks you, so you have no way to grow. But do you know that tonight the streets are and these lights in our street are and tonight the streets.
Sound check, please. 1, 2, 1, 2.
Okay.
1, 2.
Comfortable?
Yep.
So, I guess I'll start off by asking you about the film. What is the film?
The film is the story of what happened when this guy tried to make a documentary about me, but he was actually a lot more interesting than I am. So now the film is kind of about him. I mean, it's not Gone with the Wind, but there's probably a model in there somewhere.
So who is this guy?
This guy was Terry Guetta, a Frenchman who had been living in Los Angeles since emigrating to the United States in the early 1980s. A regular family man, Terry owned a vintage clothing store in the city's most bohemian shopping district, and he made a good living selling his wares to LA's more fashion-conscious citizens.
At that time, I used to buy old Adidas and old things and, you know, things you couldn't find here, shoes, bags. And I had a warehouse with big bales of these clothes and used to buy this for $50. I used to take things that, when the sewing was different, I call it designer, and I put the price that is $400. So from $50, sometime I could make $5,000.
But there was one very unusual thing about Terry. He never went anywhere without a video camera.
I don't know how the video camera came to my hand, but I know the moment came inside my hand, I couldn't live, let it down, ever. It was like more than any drugs to anybody. It was obsession. When I pick up the camera, I couldn't do anything without capturing it. I keep filming, keep filming, keep filming. I was filming and filming myself, filming. It didn't stop. It just didn't stop. In my own house, when the kid grew up, I had camera set up everywhere. I was completely nuts with camera.
Even taking pictures, he would do it like, you know, like he was using even the picture camera, like he would use a video camera. I was pretty much obsessed. He filmed constantly, tapes and tapes and tapes.
Il va bien.
As time passed, those who knew Terry stopped even noticing his ever-present camera. While everyone else soon learned how determined he could be.
Can I take one picture and I go?
One, and I go. No.
All right,
thanks.
C'est Jacques. Hey, how you doing?
Hello, man.
Ça va?
Hello.
Say hello to the French
hello,
people.
Hello, French people. That's enough. Stop recording.
That's good. Okay. Good. Why don't you go film someone else?
Yeah, I do.
Right?
I do.
Why don't you go and do it now?
Because it's not every day that I see.
Terry seemed happy enough selling clothes and pointing his camera at anything that moved. Until in 1999, on a family holiday to France, a chance discovery sent Terry's life in a dramatic new direction.
My cousin, at that time, he was artistic, you know. He was putting mosaic together and trying to do the game of Space Invaders, recreating the character kind of way. So I filmed him.
Ah, c'est un peu ce style, en fin de compte.
Apparemment, il y avait toujours du blanc
entre. Ouais, c'est de folie.
Ouais.
It was kind of fun because he was like doing some towel, very small. And put it in on top of couple building. And I thought it was really nice to put some stuff that you love, something that you want to express yourself, and put it outside, and people can see it. Il est pas droit, lève-le. Un petit peu plus sur le côté encore. Voilà, c'est bien.
Terry's cousin was Space Invader, a major player in an explosive new movement that would become known as street art. This hybrid form of graffiti was driven by a new generation using stickers, stencils, posters, and sculptures to make their mark by any means necessary. With the arrival of the internet, these once temporary works could be shared by an audience of millions. Street art was poised to become the biggest countercultural movement since punk. And Terry had landed right in the middle of it.
When I was with Terry, Terry was with his camera, and he was filming me all the time. But when people were asking me what this guy is doing, I was saying, it's okay, it's my cousin. And generally, people were thinking, oh, this guy is cool, let him film.
Mais c'est ton métier ou
pas? Bah, c'est ma passion.
Qu'est-ce que tu fais pour gagner ta vie?
J'ai fait plein de petits trucs, et aujourd'hui, je fais un break. Through my cousin, I met André. André has this character that is a smiling face that blinking an eye and, you know, with like long legs and walking everywhere, you know, like kind of a cartoon character. And I met Zeus. He was like painting like shadows on the street of different things. I liked to capture those people because I thought it was nice what they were doing. And they really believe it. You know, they really loved it. I started to really see like a gallery outside.
Fais gaffe de pas marcher sur la peinture.
C'est la fin. Salut. I I just loved it, you know, filming at night and street, because it was like a mix of fears and getting something that nobody sees. And somewhere you are illegal and you can get caught, you know? So it was like that feeling that it was like a danger. And I like that, you know, I like the danger. You know, it made me feel good.
Terry had accidentally found a focus. The man who would film anything had stumbled into an intriguing underground world. And now that he had found it, he wasn't about to let it go.
I guess Terry was in the right place at the right time, really. I mean, the thing is that most normal art is built to last like hundreds of years. It's cast in bronze or it's oil on canvas, but street art has a short lifespan, so it needed documenting. You know, we all needed someone who knew how to use a camera.
Fuck.
A few months later, Invader visited Los Angeles for the first time, giving Terry the chance to pursue his new passion on home turf.
Okay, allez, viens, les flics.
You can't do that here.
It's to take pictures.
Right, not here, not that. No, that's graffiti.
That's not graffiti. But that's not graffiti.
Then remove it.
That's an art.
You guys need to go.
But this is like Space Invader. You know Space Invader?
I know Space Invader, not here, no.
You don't know Space Invader?
Go!
I was filming Space Invader, but I wanted more. You know, so that means it's like I could get him all the time. So I wanted somebody that I couldn't get.
Terry's opportunity to meet someone who could keep him in steady thrills came a few days later when Invader arranged to meet up with another West Coast street artist. His name was Shepard Fairey. One day, Shepard would be famous for transforming the face of an unknown senator into a universally recognized icon. But even back in 2000, Shepard was the world's most prolific street artist. Shepard's experiment with the power of repetition went back to 1989 and an image based on cult 70s wrestler Andre the Giant. Combining Andre's face with a command to obey, Shepard had already clocked up over 1 million hits around the world. And although he didn't know it yet, his world was about to collide head-on with Terry's.
Shepard Fairey was at Kinko's on Vine, and Space Invader had something, a trouble or something, and he couldn't make it that moment. But me, I wanted to meet the guy. So what I did, I went and meet him.
Invader?
No, Terry.
I didn't ask him, I just filmed. That was my thing. I didn't ask him anything. When I came with the camera and I started filming.
So what did you do here?
You don't know? Oh, you knew the guy.
Funny looking.
Oh, yeah, you didn't know?
No, I didn't know.
Do you think he's dead or?
Oh, he's dead, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So you have a partner work with you, huh?
Yeah.
This is so Amanda. You put Amanda, how are you doing?
Hi.
Nice to meet you. So how long have you been doing this?
10 and a half years.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, it's a lot of paper.
Yeah.
What do you do?
I film.
That night, when Shepard did meet Space Invader, he took him on a tour of the city.
Terry was there, filming everything that Space Invader was doing, and then
of course, once I was with Space Invader, everything I was doing.
You should probably put an Invader up on Hollywood Boulevard. What do you think, Terry? Yeah.
And when Invader returned to France, Terry simply carried on, tagging along at Shepherd's side whenever the artist went out in the streets.
2 o'clock, if he's going to be out past 2 o'clock, he needs to call at 2.
Okay, I make him.
Otherwise, he gets beat and he sleeps on the couch.
Amanda always thought that he was weird, but I said, it's great that we're getting a lot of this stuff on tape. And for me to have someone there as a lookout was always good.
Keep your eye out for the cops.
I finally did train him to not turn the light on while I was on a billboard or a rooftop or he was going to blow my cover.
No, don't use that.
Yeah.
After 10 months of Terry's constant presence, the question inevitably arose, what exactly was Terry filming for?
It's cool though, right?
And that was the moment Terry came up with a big idea that would dictate the path of his life for the next 8 years.
In the beginning, you're like thinking, like, the guy's gonna film me one time, two time, three time, five time, 10 time, 12 time. But after a while, he's like, what you gonna do? Because usually people film a day, 2 days, 3 days, and they make something out of it. But I kept filming, so he's like, what you gonna do? And I said, I'm gonna make a street art documentary, you know?
Take two.
In his new role as documentary filmmaker, Terry now started traveling the world with Shepherd, recording every detail of the artist's life.
I knew that couldn't be far away. Even though the Andre the Giant sticker was just an inside joke and I was just having fun, I liked the idea of the more stickers that are out there, the more important it seems, the more important it seems, the more people want to know what it is, the more they ask each other, and it gains real power from perceived power.
Talking for a second? Please, officer, I'm not going to arrest you. I'm not going to arrest you. I just want to talk to you, dude.
Don't film from that side. Film from this side over here. You understand why, right? Because you're going to attract attention.
It was like a big adventure every night. We were going on top of building and going on top of something that was not just illegal, was dangerous. But I would do it because I wanted to show that I could do it. You know, it was not like I'm downstairs and you upstairs doing your thing and I'm filming. No, I would go upstairs and I would go even up more to have the shot that is great.
He just wanted to go whenever I was going, and he was always very diligent about climbing, about helping move the buckets, the ladder. He was not only a filmer, but in ways he was an accomplice. And I don't know whether it's just that he's passionate or whether it's that he's passionate and he's kind of crazy, but I respect passion.
But it wasn't just Shepherd who caught Terry's eye. As he ventured further afield, Terry was constantly meeting new street artists.
And in my head, I wanted to make a movie about street art. So I wanted to get as much people as possible. Even people who tell me, no, I don't want to be filmed, I find a way of making the no as a yes.
Oh, cool. I love the design of it. So you draw,
You know how to draw?
It's a painting.
Yeah.
And I start to know one, and one make me meet another one.
It's very important when you put a poster to see where you're gonna put it.
Usually I choose a wall because I like it. I like what it feels like, you know, the texture.
When I go with the artists, I'm just living them life. You know, I'm a ghost when I'm with them. I'm kind of a ghost.
Don't you wish to be taller someday?
Shut the fuck up.
So what name you were using?
Borf. It was the name of my best friend who killed himself when we were 16. And I just do it to, I don't know, commemorate his life.
You're gonna hit that side, huh?
We're gonna do both.
Are you gonna do both?
Yeah. But like, I think it'd be cool if you came up with us.
Excuse me,
can I just have a quick word with you, please?
Yeah.
If I can ask you to stop any recording that you're doing.
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine.
It's okay.
Do you understand English?
Yes, yeah, I do.
That's fine, sir. So, ladies, I'm sure you can appreciate graffiti is a criminal offence, right?
Okay.
Terry's documentary was shaping up to be the authentic inside story of the birth of a movement, starring the biggest figures in the street art world. With one exception.
Now, Tate Britain in Pimlico refused to discuss security arrangements today after a graffiti artist known as Banksy was able to leave one of his own paintings in the gallery's landscape room.
I hear about this Banksy. Who's Banksy? Banksy, he's this. And I said, I really like that guy, you know? And it's like, I want to interview this guy.
Terry wasn't the only one intrigued. By now, word about this mystery provocateur and his increasingly ambitious adventures was radiating far beyond the world of street art. Banksy had started out as a provincial graffiti artist, but before long, his stencils were appearing all over Britain. Through a series of DIY art shows, Banksy was now taking vandalism in an entirely new direction.
I asked Space Invader, I asked everybody that I knew, how can I get this guy? He said, it's impossible. It's impossible. But my focus and my head, it was like, how I'm gonna make it? How I'm gonna make it? It's impossible, but how I'm gonna make it?
While Terry schemed to find a way to the one missing star of his film, his other subjects carried on, letting Terry capture every moment of their creative process. What none of them suspected was that Terry's street art documentary didn't actually exist.
All the tape that I filmed, even if it was good, it was going nowhere. It was going in a box somewhere. Sometimes I don't even write anything. Sometimes I write the year. Sometimes I write nothing. But I would never watch it. Never, never, never. When it was filmed, for me it was done. It wasn't important how it was made. It was important what it was. It was the capturation.
Terry's extraordinary habit of filming everything and locking the unwatched tapes away in boxes had its roots in his childhood in France.
I lost my mother when I was 11 years old. And the day that I find out about my mother, I was at school. I remember I was in the playground and somebody come up and he says, oh, you laughing, huh? You laughing, huh? You laughing, huh? Like behind the gate. Your mother is dead, like this. And after I was like, I didn't know in reality. And after I went back to class and I was crying and I didn't know. And from that things, they took me away. I never went home again. I went to a cousin or something outside of what happened, not to see anything. You know, they just took me away from everything happened.
The youngest in a large family, his mother's illness had been kept from Terry. And after her death, the sense that he had missed such an important event stayed with him. Later, as an adult raising his own family, Terry became increasingly compelled by the need to record the people and events around him.
You know, I felt like I should capture everything in film because I felt like everything that I would capture at this moment, any time in my life, would be the last time that I would see it the same way. It was like a need to be captured. I would make them live forever, those moments, you know, forever and ever. Making a documentary, it was like having the key of getting all these people. That's why I kept following them, following them, following them. And because I never made a movie before, and I don't know how to stop, and I don't know how to stop, I kept going.
As Terry persevered with his quest to capture the world of street art in its entirety, the profile of the one artist who eluded him was about to become bigger than ever.
Israeli army fire to pull off his latest stunt, subversive graffiti artist Banksy, whose work...
By targeting the world's most notorious wall, Banksy turned a spot of hit-and-run vandalism into an international news event. Now it seemed everyone wanted to know the answer to one question. Who was Banksy? His work seemed to be everywhere, but the artist himself remained as elusive as ever.
He was like the only one that I don't have. And people that used to be in street art, they all tell you, he doesn't have a phone. Or they even if they do have it, they wouldn't give it to me. You know, I didn't know what way that I'm gonna get this person, you know, what angels were gonna bring me to that person.
With no leads to go on, Terry was forced to accept that he may never find a way to the mysterious Englishman. And then, miraculously.
So I went to Los Angeles in about spring 2006 and, when I got there, the guy that was supposed to be helping me got turned back at immigration, so I rang any person I knew in Los Angeles and asked them if they could help me. And they said, well, there's this French guy, he's a cousin of Space Invader, and he knows where all the best walls are in LA. He can help you out.
I was in downtown Los Angeles one day. My phone rings. Hello? Hello, this is Shepard Fairey. How you doing, Terry? Yeah. Do you have any wall? Because I have Banksy here, and I would like. And I said, what? You have who? I'm like, there is Banksy here, and I'm like, where are you? red light I stay, I go through the red light. I was driving like crazy. I mean, I'm lucky I didn't get caught that day.
So this guy shows up looking like something out of the 1860s with these like huge sideburns, sweating, telling me he could do anything, he could take me anywhere, he could get me whatever I wanted. He could fix it all up.
Yeah. I'm like, what do you want? Anything you want, what do you want?
He said, have you got a phone? And I said, no. So he went to a phone shop over the road and bought me a phone. And he bought $100 worth of credit and punched his number in and said, right, this is my number. You call me. I have everything you need.
I drive you if you need to go anywhere. I'll take care of you, whatever. I'll be your driver. I'm not doing anything and anytime.
So on the understanding that he would just help me make some paintings, we went out that evening.
Circumstances had conspired to bring Terry face to face with the notoriously secretive artist, and fate remained on Terry's side when he got his camera out.
Well, I'd never let anybody film anything before, but I said he could film me, but only my hands, from behind, and on condition that I could check the tapes afterwards.
It was magic that this person let me film, you know. I felt like I had the piece that will finish the puzzle. It was like getting something, and the daylight, that what you see in the nightlight. It was even more than I expected. I mean, he was like just incredible. He was cool. He was human. He is. He's really like what he represents. You know, he's really like. I think he's really like. I really liked him.
For the rest of Banksy's stay, Terry made himself indispensable, leading the artist to some of the best painting spots in the city.
I mean, Terry was the perfect host if you're a graffiti writer miles from home. He had no fear. He wanted to keep going all night long. And he had a massive ladder.
A few weeks after their chance encounter in LA, Banksy invited Terry to England.
I always avoided cameras because what I do is in a bit of a legal grey area, but I brought Terry over to London because it seemed like a good idea to start videoing the work. I mean, we had to because, you know, a lot of it was starting to disappear the next day.
But Banksy's close-knit team of trusted friends was horrified by the sudden appearance of this camera-happy Frenchman.
The first time Terry was filming Banksy, it was like, what the fuck is going on? I thought, you know, that nobody was allowed to do this. I felt it was a big breach of security. Being the man of mystery and being filmed at the same time, it's a slight oxymoron, I think. It's a very dangerous thing.
All the people who was working with him, they didn't understand. They look at me like, who's this guy? Who's this guy? You know, what he's gonna do to us, you know? And he didn't care whatsoever.
2-3. I guess Terry showed up at a time when I realized that the reaction to this stuff was, you know, one of the most interesting things about it. Because for me, it's an important part of the job to run away as soon as we've done it. But at least with Terry, we had someone hanging around afterwards who could capture some of it.
This is when I saw that he was like a legend. He was like kind of a Robin Hood or something.
You know Banksy?
Yeah.
You know Banksy?
I don't know.
He does very, very good graffiti.
Looks a bit like Banksy, but I know he's doing a bit more installations at the moment. And I like it, I like it.
What do you think of it?
Someone is annoyed with BT telephones.
Yeah, we were, you know, laughing like trains at all this stuff he got out of it. So yeah, he proved his worth on that project, brought something to it that we would never have had otherwise.
Over the rest of his time in London, Banksy took Terry everywhere, even allowing him to film inside his studio as he prepared for his first big American show.
He opened his door to me, and it was magic, kind of way. You ask the question, why me? In the end, why?
I think maybe Terry was like a bit of a release for me, you know? Having spent years of trying to keep everything completely under wraps, maybe I needed to trust somebody. I mean, I guess part of the power of Terry is this unlikely, the unlikeliness of him. Yeah, you know, I guess he became my friend. It's all money. Lady Di instead of the Queen.
That's so cool.
I made £1 million worth and I was going to throw it off a building just like, but I took some out and I handed some out at a festival and people spent them and people were like, oh yeah, two beers, got the beers. Nobody noticed because when you go like this, you can actually spend them.
How did you know?
And when that happened, it was like, holy shit, we just forged £1 million. And obviously for that you go to jail for 10 years.
Wow.
So I have her up here, but I don't know what to do with her.
You find it here?
I made it.
Ah, you made this?
For fuck's sake, I bring it here.
Oh my God.
Back in LA, Terry struggled to keep himself entertained after the high of his scoop with Banksy.
I'm like a bird. I always thought of that. I'm like a bird. I never want to be locked down anywhere. I like to fly from one artist to another. You know, that's the way that I live, one life to another. You know, I like to be free. You know, my wife was worried because, you know, bill to pay and... And me, the only thing I wanted to do is like buy some tape and go somewhere, you know. I wasn't worried, but I'm sure my wife had little problem of sleeping sometime.
He was following the artist and he goes to here, goes there, and I worry for my kids. I worry for everybody actually, but he doesn't care. He just goes and does. And he forgets, he comes with a family. You know, just, we need him.
Bye, Gigi, bye, Jackie.
Bye!
I love you.
For 5 years, Terry's family had learnt to cope with his endless trips away. But now, there was a new development taking up his time.
The way it started, I took picture of me holding a camera and I asked somebody to illustrate it. And I liked it, so I made a small sticker. And I made it transparent, you know, because I never saw it transparent. Transparent looked like a little stencil kind of way. And I liked it, so I went to Kinko's because I learned from Obe and things like this. And I started making that photocopy, 30 feet by 40 feet high, you know. And I went at 10 o'clock at night until 8 o'clock in the morning. And I made like this image giant of me with the camera. that big image, I thought it was kind of cool. And I started doing it kind of the same story of Old Bay, following up the movement of street art. I start to make copies, make it bigger, and starting to put it all around the city. The enjoyment of taking the glue and making the thing and going, I was like addict. It was like a spiral, and I just fall in it. I just fall in the spiral. Ah, I fall like making the art.
A few months after Terry had seen him in London, Banksy returned to Los Angeles. He had arrived with his crew to transform a large, rundown warehouse into the venue for his first major US exhibition, Barely Legal.
Oh my God. It's really big. It's giant. 3D. It's the biggest elephant I ever saw in my life. Look at this. It's really big.
Yeah. But Banksy had more on his mind than getting the show's surprise guest ready for her big moment.
We were right in the middle of putting the show together. And I had this idea to make a piece about Guantanamo Bay and the detention of all these terror suspects. So I took Terry with me, and we didn't tell anyone else about it. And we just shot off, like, in the morning before the show opened.
I came, pick him up, just me and him. You know, I'm kind of excited. I'm going to Disneyland.
It was around the anniversary of September the 11th, so it was a pretty high-tempo moment.
Can I get two adults just for Disneyland, please?
$2 is your change, and your two Disneyland tickets.
Is Mickey Mouse going to be there today?
Yes, Mickey Mouse will be there. You go to Toontown, and he's waiting for you guys.
So we've been wandering around the park for a while, and then there's this sign with a picture of a camera on it saying, this will be a great place to take your souvenir photo. So that obviously seemed like the best place to put him.
He's like, this is where I'm gonna do it. And I'm like, okay. He goes in a corner and starting to blow up to pump a doll. And he goes, and he starts putting it in. And he put it. He attached it to the metal bars, and it takes time. And it was kind of suspense because, you know, it's Disneyland. There is people who come.
And left Terry there filming it.
And me, I'm filming, taking pictures, because it's like, you know, it's like the moment that I'm here for. In one moment, they stop the train. We start to see some people coming in. Security and people like this, but not dressed like security, but look like, you know, like people who is not at Disneyland to have fun, you know? So I'm starting to feel scared. I'm walking to leave. One guy is behind me, two guys behind me, three guys behind me, four guys behind me. And one moment, bam, 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 from every corner, they hold me.
I went in the toilets, I changed my hat, I changed my shirt. Then I went out and I went on the, like, Indiana Jones ride. And then when I came off that, I tried calling Terry, didn't get any answer. So then I went on Pirates of the Caribbean.
While Banksy went on the rides, Terry was being introduced to a very different side of the Magic Kingdom.
So they put me on a seat. There is a guy here, a guy there. And they said, you are in big, big, big trouble.
So they actually started shutting down parts of the park. There was like walkie-talkies crackling everywhere, and all of a sudden it seemed to be a very, very serious thing indeed.
Held in an interrogation room, Terry was questioned by Disney's security people and one man who claimed he was from the FBI.
I'm like, I don't know what you have for me. I was there. You like telling me that I have something to do with this person. I don't have anything to do with this person. I don't have anything to do. I mean, I was there at the wrong time, at the wrong moment. You know, I was taking pictures and things like this. And he says, did you take a lot of pictures? And I said, no, I took one pictures and things like this. But I even deleted when you guys came to me. No, the camera is on the table. It's full of pictures. And I'm telling that to the guy. So I'm lying completely. The only thing he has to do is to turn on that camera.
So I tried Terry again, and this time he answered, and I said, where are you? And he said, hello, my cherie, and how are you, my darling? And how are the children? And I thought, yeah, at that point, I thought I'd better leave the park.
He's like, okay, show me the pictures. I take the camera. I take him. I said, look, I put it on. I go in menu right away. I go and delete, and I go, and the thing goes, and I go, bam, I put it down, and I said, I don't have any picture on him, and I don't have any proof on you. I don't have nothing with you guys, and I don't have nothing with this guy, because I don't know who it is. Like this, I don't, you know, I'm clear.
After 4 hours of questioning, with no evidence to hold him, Terry was released.
So after Terry withstood interrogation from the entire Mickey Mouse security team, didn't fold, didn't buckle, he did a really good job of stashing the tape in his sock. But I guess I trusted Terry with everything. He was my guy after that.
Hey man, how are you? See you.
The day after his close shave at Disneyland, Terry, along with half of Hollywood, was at the opening party for Banksy's show. It was an even bigger star, however, who provoked the real sensation. Banksy had camouflaged his rented elephant with 12 litres of children's face paint in an apparent statement about how easy it is to ignore the things right in front of us. But the American news media could only see what was right in front of them, and came flocking to report on the elephant in the room.
I'm Angie Crouch. Coming up at 5:30, animal rights activists are outraged over an art exhibit involving a live, painted
There's
elephant.
There's an elephant in the room, a problem that we never talk about since this small white card given to visitors. What's the matter?
Say when. You already got your interview, so can you...
The magical combination of controversy, celebrity, and the painted elephant turned the show into an event.
We had the sort of attendance that you get for a decent show at the Museum of Modern Art or something, only over 3 days and in Skid Row. So I think a lot of the people in the art world were a little bit confused as to how that would happen, you know? As were we, to be honest.
Barely Legal marked the point at which street art was forced into the spotlight, attracting sudden interest from the art establishment. In the months that followed, prices for work by leading street artists rocketed, with collectors rushing to get in on this exciting new market.
Lot number 33A, the Banksy, the vandalised phone box. And I'll start here at $100,000, $100,000, $110,000, $120,000, $130,000, $140,000.
Street art had become a white-hot commodity. Now, no serious contemporary art collection would be complete without a Banksy.
$550,000.
Those little bunnies are Warhols.
That's a Lichtenstein. And then that's Keith Haring, who I'm not a fan of.
The Andy Warhol Mao is the first thing I ever bought. I was like 20 years old, and I put it on layaway, and it's a, you know, the smaller Mao. And it's beautiful. I mean, it's beautiful, but it's in the closet.
Oh, yeah, here's a big Banksy. That one's from the show in L.A.
I saw Banksy, and I thought he was a genius. And every person I told about it bought something, like people who have Picassos and, you know, Mondrians and Paul Klee and, God, I don't even know who else. They have, I mean, serious collections.
So then these famous auction houses, all of a sudden they were selling street art, and everything was going a bit crazy, and suddenly it all become about the money, but it never was about the money. So I said to Terry, right, you have the footage, you can tell the real story of what this art is about. It's not about the hype, it's not about the money, now is the time. You need to get your film out.
Banksy had put Terry well and truly on the spot. He now had to devise a way to transform thousands of hours of unwatched tapes into the epic documentary he had been promising everyone for so long.
So we start working on the back of my house, doing some editing. It was like kind of a vision that I saw. And the way that I made it, I really did it kind of the way, you know, like when you have a bucket and you have a lot of numbers and you said, you look and one and you open and you said, this is the number 12. This is the way that I made it, kind of way. I just took couple tape here, couple tape here, couple tape here, couple tape here. Take a little piece of here, little piece of there, little piece of there. And this is the way that I made it.
Okay, now. Let's go back a little bit and do a review because I'm...
Like what I say, I'm playing chess. I don't know how to play chess, but life is a chess game for me.
The following spring, Terry returned to England.
I'm gonna do a flip.
All his years of filming and thousands of hours of material had been crafted into a 90-minute film with the intriguing title, Life Remote Control.
He called up and he came to London because he said he'd nearly finished the film, and he came round my house and put the DVD on and he said, this is it, it's nearly finished. Actually a filmmaker, and he was maybe just someone with mental problems who happened to have a camera. It just seemed to go on and on. It was an hour and a half of unwatchable nightmare trailers, essentially like somebody with a short attention span with a remote control flicking through a cable box of 900 channels.
Peace to the whole world.
You have to keep an eye on the big picture.
I told him I'd never seen anything like it, and I wasn't lying about that. Yeah, I was faced with that terrible thing when somebody shows you their work and everything about it is shit, so you don't really know where to start.
He's like, it's good, you know? It's good, you know, it's good.
I mean, the thing is that Terry had all this amazing footage of all this stuff that, you know, in this tiny world of street art was kind of important, and it was never going to happen again. So it felt right to at least make something that you could actually watch about it. So I thought, you know, maybe I could have a go. I mean, I don't know how to make a film, but obviously that hadn't stopped Terry, but I needed him out of the way in order to do it. So I said, why don't you go and put up some more of your posters and make some art? You know, have a little show, invite a few people, get some bottles of wine, and off he went back to Los Angeles and he left me with the tapes.
Terry returned home to Los Angeles full of enthusiasm for his unexpected new assignment. Banksy had just given him what he considered to be a direct order to put down his camera and become a street artist himself.
I think he put me into street art because I like what he did. Me as respecting him, you know, having him to push you to do street art, I just went and like, it was not even a push, it was like an enjoyment to get pushed, you know.
So now, using the formula he had seen work so well for the world's biggest street artists, Terry set about creating his own alter ego and iconic visual style.
I came up with the idea that the whole movement of art is all about brainwashing. Obey is about brainwashing. Banksy is about brainwashing. So I use MBW, and I am Mr. Brainwash.
But Mr. Brainwash had some catching up to do. Many of the biggest names in the street art world had moved on to gallery shows, so Terry now started to plan the next phase of his artistic career.
Oh, putain. Film, film, viens là. Regarde, rose. Putain, la merde. Oh, j'ai niqué tout.
When Banksy had suggested to Terry that he make some art, he could never have imagined just how far things would go. Terry had now remortgaged his business and sold off whatever he could to invest in a huge studio, screen printing equipment, and a full-time staff capable of producing MBW pieces on a commercial scale.
Just wait 1 second. Okay. No. Yes. Yes. When you have Damien Hirst, one of the most expensive artists in our generation today, and having 100 people working for him, do you think that he's going to come and cut little papers and start to glue? No. I'm not going to make it. I'm just going to come with the idea and said, this is what I want. And I want this like that. No.
Terry's creative process, I guess, he's inspired by other things, but I guess who isn't inspired by other things? We have, like, look at this, like, he goes and he, like, four different color post-its in here, that means, no, five, I think. So he went through this book four or five times and, like, selected different pictures, wrote notes, and they're all in, like, fairly bad English. Terry goes through the books, he finds the paintings that he likes, and he comes up with the ideas on what to change them. And we scan the image and then in Photoshop.
This one is Elvis. It's like a piece that I made. It's like I changed Elvis. He had a guitar, and I put him a toy from Fisher-Price. You know, a toy from Fisher-Price. And this piece called Don't Be Cruel. And this is what I create. It's like to trying to do some lines that when you're close to it, when you're really close to it, you just see lines. Any kind of people,
they come to the market and what they see, barcode. They come to the thing. So they live with it. They brainwash. That's why I call myself Mr. Brainwash. It's because everything that I do somewhere brainwash your face. This is one piece that I really like, kind of way. And it says, Bat Papi, 1893. It's before Batman. It's Bat Papi. You know, the Papi is the father of the grandfather of Batman. You know, that's who started, you know.
While most artists worked their way up from small beginnings, Terry was determined that Mr. Brainwash would arrive with a bang. The former CBS studio complex, covering 15,000 square feet in the heart of old Hollywood, had lain empty for almost a year until Terry decided it would make the perfect venue for his debut show, Life is Beautiful.
I didn't want to disappoint Banksy. I wanted to try to do something big.
And the end is gonna become like a big space with pictures all around. I want to make it more like a show. Like there is a park amusement, I'm making it an art amusement. You know, I changed park to art.
Terry's plan was to emulate Banksy's LA show by transforming the cavernous space into a street art spectacular, filled not just with paintings, but sculptures and installations too.
And if he didn't know how to do any of these things himself, he could always employ people who did.
I answered a nondescript ad looking for sculptors or artists who could work in papier-mâché.
He said he just needed some things built, and he wanted to know if I could build him an 8-foot-tall spray paint can, and I said, absolutely. And he said, can you build me a monster out of TVs? And I said, sure.
And then he actually got us into the space and had us working on a day rate so that he could kind of keep coming up with projects and change them around.
With a growing workforce and Terry adding new projects by the hour, the scale of his production was now running far ahead of the little show Banksy had suggested.
I was so much focused on it that I put all my money in it. Everything that I own, I put it in it. I was refinancing the house. I was putting my life and the border of losing everything that I owned.
And just when it seemed that the pressure couldn't get any more intense, and with his grand opening now set for just 3 weeks away, disaster struck.
So basically, this bone's called your metatarsal, and this is the fifth one. It's all the way on the side of your foot. And you fractured it right through here, and this piece has been pulled back a little bit. Do you see that?
Yeah.
Needing an operation, Terry was ordered to slow things down. And now, under the influence of pain-numbing drugs, he at last glimpsed the enormity of the enterprise he had embarked upon.
It's just so much work to do, prices, and it's like being an artist overnight. You know, that's what's happening to me. You know, I'm nobody. I never did an exposition on a gallery, really. I never show any work anywhere. And I'm doing this big show, and it's all a makeup kind of way, you know?
I mean, it was all starting to sound a little bit crazy. These reports were coming back saying that Terry had found this huge warehouse and then he'd broken his leg, and it was all kind of going a little bit wrong. You know, it sounded like he needed a little bit of help. So I rung a few people who I thought might be able to help him out.
Like, this room looks cool. This room looks interesting. This room looks almost done. If this room stayed like this, that's cool. But
that's one out of
that four, makes the rest five, of the rooms six. Look bad. Myself and my girlfriend Sonia went down there, and we figured out what he needed. Along with a few of the show's other producers, we made lists of what needed to happen.
What's the capacity of this place?
I don't know. Capacity is approximately going to be like 750 to 800.
Got it. What about getting...
I was very curious how the hell he was actually going to finish it and pull it off, and realized he didn't have a clue of a lot of the final logistics that needed to happen.
Like I saw in Banksy's show, mostly the people came and came back.
He'd seen people do big art shows. He'd been to them around the world. He figured, I want to do something just as great.
The insurance?
We're taking care.
With Roger and the team now taking care of the practical arrangements, Terry was free to spend time selecting which of his many pieces to include in the show. But instead, Terry busied himself with a different concern altogether. Hype.
He asked me to promote the show for him, to give him a quote for a press release, to send it to my mailing list, to post it on my website, and really to validate what he was doing. And I was uncomfortable with that, but I said that I would do it.
So then I got a phone call from Terry, or Mr. Brainwash, as he was now calling himself, asking if I would give him a quote to promote his show. And well, I didn't think there was any harm in it, so I wrote him a sentence and I emailed it off.
But Banksy could never have guessed what Terry had in mind for his modest contribution.
So this is gonna be like a jail. It's gonna have bar here. I'm gonna put some more can.
The endorsements were immediately picked up by the media. And within days, Terry was being interviewed by the editor of the city's biggest listings magazine, LA Weekly.
The only thing I wanna do in LA is to show that Los Angeles can have great shows. You know, it's like a revolution kind of way.
A few days later, Los Angeles awoke to discover there was a new star in town. MBW was front page news.
Okay.
Life is beautiful.
The LA Weekly also reported Terry's promotional brainwave. The first 200 people to turn up would be given a free, one-of-a-kind screen print.
Do you think that people are going to wait and wait for the 200 free posters or no?
So now, Terry had to come up with a way of turning 200 identical screen prints into unique, collectible MBW originals. With a crew of 20 people working around the clock, the building was at last beginning to resemble an art gallery. But the walls remained bare because Terry still hadn't decided which paintings to frame and hang.
So how did you like your LA Weekly?
Following all the press coverage, private collectors had begun to inquire about snapping up MBW pieces ahead of the opening, giving Terry his first insight into the value of his work.
The Campbell soup with multiply colors. Yeah, it's very nice, this one. I would say $24,000. Scarface, is it a big one? Okay, okay. So now, $30,000. Prepare me some can all over paint. Just listen to me. I mean, make them work to do something. There is nothing to do there. There is nothing to do. It's like gold, you know? Because you spray. And how much is it? $18,000. $12,000.
With his big day now upon him, Mr. Brainwash still had plenty to do. Because it was only now, just 8 hours before the doors opened, that Terry's paintings finally arrived, framed and ready to hang, almost 200 pieces in a riot of themes and styles.
I have never seen someone with so much goddamn art in one art show in my entire life. I haven't seen group shows with that much artwork. Whatever elves Terry had making that stuff, did a good job.
Outside, the first eager art fans were already starting to arrive.
We're here to see Mr. Brainwash, bro. He's holding LA right now, bro. He's up on every corner.
Come on, guys! Let's make the show go on! Fuck.
But inside, the pressure was starting to show.
Okay, there is one thing. One thing. We're gonna have a meeting one day. Starting now, this second, I'm running the show. You're not giving order to anybody right now. I'm running the show. You listen to me. Okay? Anybody's listening to me now. Okay? Okay? So now you follow me. You come in with me. This oil painting, you know where is the two? The two tomato spray over there?
Yeah.
The two? You take off the two, you hang down. Now, right. This wall. Okay, you show me. And I tell you a pal. No, a pal good and a pal not good.
No, you too.
You what? This one good. This one, I'm not sure. Middle. This one good.
By mid-afternoon, a crowd of almost 2,000 people had amassed for what was now widely tipped to be the hottest art event of the year.
How'd you guys find out about this event?
LA Weekly.
Do you guys think you still have a shot at getting a print?
Yes.
I'm expecting to see a mixture of street art and pop art together. Really interesting stuff, very modern. No one's really done it the way he's done it.
You know, it's one of those kind of things, man. Not quite sure what I'm in for, but I'm excited about it.
But Terry was still finding distractions from the task in hand.
Who are you and what do you do?
I'm Mr. Brainwash. I was a filmmaker. I mean, I am still a filmmaker and I started filming, I felt like, because I love art. Sometime in life you have to go.
Ça va mal tourner, il n'y a rien sur les murs. Il faut que tu décides, Thierry. On a toute la grande room qui est vide.
Okay. Can they unroll all the canvas?
Ça, il le fait. J'ai donné un truc. Maintenant, c'est les autres grands murs qui sont en face.
Okay, I need you to just to take oil painting and put them in the small room.
Je les mets.
Tu les mets n'importe comment dans
ça,
la small room.
Ça, c'est fait. Maintenant, c'est dans la grande pièce.
Dans la grande pièce, tu les mets comme ça. Et après, moi, je vois, je dis ça là,
dans
ça là.
Pièce.
Dans la grande pièce, tu les sors tout. Ouais, et les canvas, il me les met à plat, après moi je dis celui-là. Okay.
No, it's okay, I understand.
Okay, it's okay, I can do another 3 minutes, it's okay.
Eventually, with only 3 hours left to get everything ready, the crew started putting the paintings up on the walls themselves.
I brought in three of my staff members that have been here since 3:30 or 4 working, hanging stuff, moving stuff, carrying stuff, you know, working just as hard as the guys Terry brought in, realizing that frankly, he's just kind of retarded.
Almost certain this is probably my last MBW show I'll be working on.
Finally, the doors opened to a public eager to feast their eyes on the grand debut of Mr. Brainwash.
It's a triumph. It will go down in history. I'm glad my friends turned me on to this.
There should be more stuff like this in Los Angeles. They say that art is dead, but sweetie, it's all around us. Great. Bravo.
It looks like it's sort of a one-trick pony, but I think if you look at it, particularly in context as an entire body of work, I think he's exploring some interesting notions around celebrity.
I never met the cat till tonight, but this food's down for his dog.
With over 4,000 people flowing through the venue, Terry's entree into the art world was nothing less than a sensation.
Amazing. Thank you so much. Fantastic. Right on.
Yes.
LA's art fans watched spellbound as a major new star was born before their very eyes. So desperate were they not to miss out on this cultural phenomenon. Those left outside felt compelled to break through the gates.
Most artists spend years perfecting their craft, finding their style, and Terry seemed to miss out on all those bits. I mean, there's no one quite like Terry, really, even if his art does look quite a lot like everyone else's.
I see this particular one reoccurring in so many different mediums. Why does that one reoccur so many times?
Because I think it's part of the pop culture. Andy Warhol passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm here.
Okay. Can you guys form a straight line to the right, please?
But the ultimate validation was measured in dollars and cents. By the end of his opening week, Terry would sell nearly $1 million worth of art. Mr. Brainwash had arrived.
He was behind my expectation, like they say. I would never thought that he would be so many people. And it's not that he was so many people, they were so happy. They were so so pleased with what they see, they were so, you know, they were so touched. Like they caught me as Banksy, and like they said that I'm as good as that, you know. So I mean, I love it, you know. Somewhere it's great, but from the people, I think I got accepted, you know. Comes to a point that I get accepted.
Originally booked to run for just 5 days, Life is Beautiful stayed open for a further 2 months. And as word about MBW spread, his pieces appeared in galleries and shows around the world, from Miami and New York to London, Paris, and even Beijing.
He's kind of the rightful heir to Andy Warhol, in a way. Andy Warhol made a statement by repeating famous icons until they became meaningless, but he was extremely iconic in the way that he did it. But then Terry really made them meaningless.
How do I feel about being partially responsible for creating Mr. Brainwash? I feel like I had the best intentions. I think even when you have the best intentions, sometimes things can go awry. To put a huge body of work together and sort of try to, you know, come out as if he is a fully formed artist ready for the world stage, I think was a little premature.
I feel good. I feel good as an artist to have a reputation now, you know. An artist is not a guy that you see in one show and you can decide who it is, or if he copies Banksy, or if he copies Shepherd Fairey, or if he copies... It's about time. You'll see in the time who I will be. Because with time, you'll see my creativity. You'll see if I'm a real artist or not.
I do think that the whole phenomenon of Terry's obsession with street art, becoming a street artist, a lot of suckers buying into his show and him selling a lot of expensive art very quickly. It's anthropologically, sociologically, it's a fascinating thing to observe. And maybe there's some things to be learned from it.
I don't know what it means, Terry's huge success and arrival in the art world. I mean, maybe Terry was a genius all along. Maybe he got a bit lucky. Maybe it means art is a bit of a joke.
If Terry can pull it off, then amazing. But, you know, it's kind of... I think the joke is on... I don't know who the joke's on, really. I don't even know if there is a joke.
I don't think Terry played by the rules in some ways, but then there aren't supposed to be any rules. So I don't really know what the moral is. I mean, I always used to encourage everyone I met to make art. I used to think everyone should do it. I don't really do that so much anymore.
Some people, you know, might think that I'm a rabbit because I'm running around and they think that I'm not organized. But I said, wait till the end of life and you'll see if I'm a rabbit or a turtle.
Nothing ever mattered more than not doubting. street.